Are you ready? The Cornelia Stephanie Show. Wake up to love, your call to action. Join Cornelia as she empowers others to live heaven on earth. Cornelia teaches listeners how to be the authority over yourself, embracing your inner guru. Feel yourself uplifted into limitless expansion, integrating ease and grace in a changing world. This show will cover topics such as unconditional love, your physical body, how to be in extraordinary relationships, create financial and emotional wealth, embracing entrepreneurship in the new earth. Hello, everyone. It's Friday. Welcome to the Cornelia Stephanie Show. It's an honor and a pleasure to be with you. We've got our stories of hope. I have my first guest right here with me in the green room, brought him onto the show. I'm going to introduce him to you right now. We've been talking on backstage about the dark night of the soul. That's the subject today of what we're going to talk about. But let me tell you a little bit of backstory about Ben Neal. He has a background in sales and finance. After experiencing a series of catastrophic and life-altering events in 2009, which included the end of his long-term relationship with his significant other, total financial loss, and the tragic death of his mother, which Ben refers to as his dark night of the soul, he became an avid student. Inspired by a speech that he discovered by the late O.G. Mandino, Ben began his journey of self-discovery. Since that time, he has read more than 1,500 books on subjects ranging from psychology, NLP, Eastern philosophy, metaphysics, and ancient wisdom in an effort to fully understand the workings of the mind. Inspired by the works of O.G. Mandino, Stephen Pressfield, Paul Coelho, Greg Braden, James Redfield, Deepak Chopra, and many more, Ben began writing his first novel called The Initiate in 2014. This book is a highly emotional story that closely describes Ben's personal experience as he set out on his path to self-discovery, which led to his spiritual awakening. Originally from San Diego, California, Ben currently lives with his family in Salt Lake City, Utah. He is currently working on his second book, The Initiate series. Welcome to the show today, Ben.
Thank you. Thanks for having me, Cornelia. I really appreciate it. It's great to be here.
Great. It's wonderful to have you. So we touched on quite a few subjects, from the economy that is really right now going through a massive wobble and, you know, massive shift that we all know about. And then also the deep, deep work when we have that inner peace, that deep inner peace, but only after facing the dark night of the soul. You have an intimate experience about that. Do you want to tell us a little bit about that?
Sure, absolutely. So 2009 for me, you know, I've been in the mortgage business since 2001, and 2009 was pretty much mortgage meltdown, the whole economy, right? And so that sort of started it. And then my relationship was on the rocks, all that good stuff. And then to top it all off, my mom passed, died in a fire when her building caught on fire. And rough times for sure. And it really forced me to rethink and reevaluate everything. I sort of lost my identity in the process. And that's the dark night of the soul, for those that are unfamiliar with the terminology. Historically, you know, it's a good experience, even though it's, when you're in the middle of one, it's not. It's extremely painful because you lose this identity. But what it does is it helps those who become lost in this physical experience, who sort of identify with their physical being, so to speak, and believe, you know, this tiny sliver of who they are, this ego they have, these ideas they've built up of who they are, dominates their life, so to speak. And so the purpose of the dark night of the soul was always, even in ancient times, was to help the initiate, right? And I consider all of us to be sort of initiates, so to speak. We're all on this path together, right? This path of self-discovery and expansion of the soul, and so to speak. But then the initiates in these exercises they would put them through would essentially experience their greatest fears. They would come into their reality, right? Like the story of Job and that type of thing. And through this process, they would typically have an out-of-body experience, and they would see their body laying there, they'd be above it, and that experience really helped them to recognize that they weren't their experience, and they were so much greater than their experience, and even though their body was there, they weren't. The essence of their being existed on a plane above this physical plane, and so the only things that really had the power to affect them from this experience, they realized, would be, hey, the physical world can't really affect the essence of who I am. No matter what happens to me, I'm so much greater than this. And so for me, it really helped me to recognize that perhaps, yeah, there's so much more to me than this identity I had built for myself over those years of, you know, I'm this mortgage guy, I make this much money, I have these friends, I live in this neighborhood, I'm married to this gal. You know, all of those things I thought were my identity, but when those are pulled away, it's like, what do? You know, because you kind of, those are your values, right? Those are your hierarchies. That's kind of what you focus on. And with everything going on in the world today, I mean, there's a great chance we see this sort of collective dark night of the soul, so to speak, to where everything around us that we've identified with and we've been conditioned to believe is our value system, you know, it disintegrates before our eyes. And then what? And what do you do? What do you focus on? What's really important, right? Because most of us have been conditioned to believe that, you know, what we need to really feel gratified and to expand ourselves is something outside of us. It's external to us. And that we somehow come to this world inherently flawed and missing something. And that's so not the case. And we realize that, you know, as we go through this experience, but it's super painful to go through it. So it's definitely a life-altering experience, but at the same time, it's a great opportunity for us to recognize ourselves from, you know, an eternal perspective. And if we identify ourselves as spiritual beings having a physical experience, then we realize that this life experience we're having right now is just a sliver of who we are, right? We're so much greater than this, and we're so much greater than anything that can happen to us. So,
yeah. So do you feel that I feel like I'm having an echo. Did you hear that?
No, you sound all right to me.
Okay. I feel like what's happening right now is America is going through, not just America, but a lot of countries are going through a dark night of the soul as a country. And we live in these countries, right? We live in the Americas or the Ukraines or wherever we're living, right? That country is going through a dark night of the soul. And you, as an initiate, were having so many losses that you had to look at and process and feel, right? So I'm just curious, when that all began to unfold in your life, was there ever a time where you had the awareness that the universe was asking you beforehand, before 2009, to pay attention or start opening up to self-discovery, or, you know, start doing that inner work? Who am I? Why am I here? What's my purpose, right? Did you have any of these knock-knocks by the universe that came before 2009? I'm just curious.
Yes, I did, in fact. So it's interesting because, again, we're all conditioned, right, to believe, hey, you make this amount of money, and the American dream is you own a home, you make money, you get this, you get that, and you're going to be happy, right? It's all these things. And I was making pretty good money by most standards prior to this, right? Real estate was booming, everything was going well. And there was always this emptiness in the background. And no matter how much I achieved, it was never enough. And I'd always feel sort of hollow with my achievements, believe it or not. And I just, you know, you sort of, you know, make excuses like, oh, well, it's, you know, you'd look around to your friends who are making more money than you are, which I had a lot of them that were. And I would think, oh, well, they've got it figured out. I just need to get to their level. That's what I need. And it's always this ever stretching, you know, scale that you're always reaching for and moving up this ladder. And you're thinking, oh, yeah, you know, I'm getting there. And once I get that, I'll be happy. And you never are. That's the thing. There's always that emptiness that sort of sticks with you, because your needs that you have as a spiritual being can never be met by anything on the physical plane. And that's the hardest thing to figure out, I think, is a lot of us have been sold on this idea, because again, we've been sort of conditioned like our whole lives, like you need this, you need that, commercial advertising, everything, right? We need all these things to be happy, and it's really not true. But it's, nobody can tell you this. You have to experience it. It's one of those things that you just, you have to go through before you do it.
I love how you said that, how you brought up that, you know, it has to happen for everyone. So now as we as a country are going through the dark night of the soul, right? It has to happen for everyone to have that experience so that you can wake up and remember how amazing you are, how absolutely extraordinary you are, and that you are much greater than what you've been conditioned by. Absolutely. So can you believe it's already time? So I want to be able to let the audience know you are an incredible speaker, really.
Oh, thank you.
You've got a speaking career ahead of you. So definitely are an amazing speaker. And what do you do? Do you have a social media presence? Do you have a social media? I know you want us to go get your book. Give us that call to action, where to find your book, to know more about you, and how can people, you know, follow you and learn about you?
Yeah, so I have a Facebook page, the Initiate Book Series, and then the website is theinitiate.net, and then the book can be had on Amazon, either in print or in ebook form. Anybody that's sort of lost and looking for how do I move beyond this dark night of the soul, the book is, it's a story, it's a fictional story, but it's very much based upon my experiences. And I just hope it will help those that are sort of suffering through that and looking for what's the next step in this process. And it's, yeah, I know it's a difficult road. I know it's very painful, but I can promise that at the end, who you become through this process is all that matters. And it's the most important thing that can happen to you.
Yeah, that's really good. And do you know that, do you also feel that right now, even though the abundance factor where, you know, the economy is going through such change, but right now at this stage in your life, do you feel that you have the tools that you need to feel internally, eternally rich and wealthy from the inside out that you never were able to look for or receive in the outside world?
Absolutely. I pretty much hit rock bottom. And then when you're at bottom, everything's up from there. And if you can learn to, and that's the beauty of the dark night of the soul, is you face your greatest fears. You've, everything that you're afraid of becomes your reality. And as that happens, you experience that and you realize, I survived that. I'm all right. I made it through this okay. And so, yeah, going into the changes that are going to come, I'm not afraid. The money part is irrelevant. I've learned that, you know, there's nothing outside of me that can bring me what I truly need. And everything I truly need, I've already got. It's within me. And when I start removing those false layers that I believe to be myself, this ego, right, and all these things that we've identified with, when those layers get ripped away, you suddenly discover that there's a much wiser and more empowering voice within you. And if you can follow its guidance, it'll change your life.
Thank you so much, Ben Neal. Thank you for listening and tuning in, everyone. Go get the Initiate series and check out Ben's work. We're going to take a break right now. We'll be right back. Welcome back, everyone. My next guest today is Jennifer Rose Asher. She has a bachelor's degree in finance from the University of Washington, Madison, and master's degree in counseling psychology from the Adler School of Professional Psychology. She has worked in the adoption field, both as a birth mother, counselor, and as a consultant for adoptive families. Journey to My Daughter is her first book. That sounds beautiful right there. Jennifer lives in the Dallas area with her husband, 3 children, and several dogs. She's an animal lover with a passion for horses. She rides her 2-quarter horses on a drill team that performs at local rodeos. Welcome to the show, Jennifer.
Thank you so much, Cornelia.
Wow, that sounds wonderful. I mean, so what are you doing? You're riding your horses. You're an author.
Yes.
Are you coaching and counseling people too?
A little bit, not much anymore. I kind of got out of it several years ago, just because I had three kids who required more of my time, and I wasn't really able to do everything. Last year during COVID, I decided that it was time to share my story with the world. When I had worked as an adoption counselor many years ago, I would often tell the story of my daughter's adoption to the clients that I worked with. And whenever I did, they told me, you have to share this story. You have to let other families hear this story and what happened to you, because it was so inspirational for them that they just wanted to share it with everyone. At the time, it was a bit too emotional for me. I couldn't do it. I wasn't ready. Now I'm really glad. I feel like the timing was right last year, and everything happens how it's supposed to.
So are you going to tell us that story?
I'm going to tell you the beginning, because I want everybody to read my book.
Yeah,
but the gist of it is that, well, my book is my memoir, and it's about how I originally didn't want to have children. Then I finally decided that it was time, and I spent a good deal of time talking my husband into the idea. And then we tried to have a biological child. I had two miscarriages. And then as soon as I found out I was having the second miscarriage, I quickly jumped to adoption, decided to adopt a child, and went through the craziest set of things that could happen to anyone, I think, on my journey. Everything that we tried to do when we tried to force a situation, everything went wrong. Everything went wrong. And I ended up taking a last minute trip to Vietnam. And I got there, and the person who was supposed to pick me up wasn't there. And it went downhill from that. And I tried and pushed and pushed and pushed to try to do this the way I thought it should be done. And as soon as I backed off a little and let things happen, I ended up finding my daughter. And it was in somewhere I never would have expected, and through a means that I never would have expected, but it was very clearly meant to be. She was supposed to be my daughter. And when I would tell my clients this, they would say, oh my gosh, you just needed to wait for her to be born. And that's exactly the way I feel about it.
How old is your daughter today?
She will be 21 next month.
Wow.
Yes. So. And that's one of the reasons at the time when I originally wrote this story for her. I realized I was starting to forget some of the details, and I wanted to write it down. And then again, I was working with these adoptive families, so I would often tell the story, and they urged me to get it published. And I didn't, I just felt like it was too emotional. I didn't want to do it. Now I'm really glad that I waited to get her, basically to get her consent. I don't think she was old enough at the time that if I had published it when she was 5 or 6 or 7, that it would have been fair to her to have this story out in the world about her without her really being old enough to consent to that.
Wow. So how does she feel?
I think sometimes she has a little bit of mixed feelings. She does like to be the center of attention. And I know she's very proud of me and proud of the story. And she's very glad that it's able to help other families. Sometimes she gets a little bit shy about it, but in general, I think she's really thrilled, and she's been a wonderful help with promoting the book and being there as a support for me.
Yeah, I love the journey to my daughter. Is that the name of the book?
Yes. Yes.
Yeah, I love that. I love that. That's an excellent title. It's very curious. It right away invites me in and wants me to take the journey.
Yes. And the subtitle of the book is A Memoir About Adoption and Self-Discovery. Because as I wrote this journey, it was originally meant for adoptive families. Adopting a child is very, very difficult. And I think, at least for me and for many of my clients, one of the hardest things about it was that it was so unpredictable. You have friends who are pregnant, and they know that 9 months, they're going to have a baby. They know when everything's going to happen, and they can prepare. With adoption, at any given day, your baby could be born tomorrow, and it might not be born for 2 or 3 years. You never know. And that lack of focus and lack of continuity and timeline made it very, very difficult for me. I'm a little bit type A. I like to have control. I like to know when things are going to happen and be able to prepare for them. And that was totally taken away from me. So that waiting period is very, very difficult. And again, I used to tell this story because I just felt like all these things that happened to me and that seemed so tragic at the time and so upsetting at the time, they were just there in my own old words, they were just there to stall me. They were there to stall me so that I could wait for my daughter to be born. But as I wrote this story, and the story itself is wonderful. It reads like a novel. It's got all kinds of twists and turns and suspense, and it's super fun. But while I wrote it, I realized that there were all these signs that I hadn't recognized that were kind of leading me down a different path. And at the beginning, I fought these signs tooth and nail. The example I give in the beginning of my book was, we had decided that we thought we should be adopting from China. We had heard about all these little girls available for adoption in China that needed homes, that they had this one child rule. We decided we should adopt from China. But I wanted to be done. I was like, I just want my child as soon as possible. We're ready to be parents. Whatever is going to be the quickest path to bringing our daughter home. And I called agency after agency that ran adoptions through China. And they all said the same thing. There was a minimum of a 2-year wait. And I was convinced that if I called every adoption agency that went to China in the country, I was going to find one that was going to tell me that I could bring a baby home from China in 4 months. And it just wasn't realistic and it wasn't happening. And I just kept hitting my head against that wall. And I finally talked to this woman who said to me, have you ever thought of looking at Vietnam? And she explained the differences to me in their process and in the laws of the country. And I said, oh my gosh, this is the shortcut I've been looking for. But I had to be willing to see it. And for the longest time, I didn't want to hear about other countries. I didn't want to hear about other places. So the story is a lot about just my learning to kind of recognize these signs and being open to them and being willing to kind of take that other fork in the road.
Yeah, I love the story. There's so many things that are sparking within me because I always wanted to adopt, and that still might be something that I'm going to do. So definitely I'm going to get that book. So Journey to My Daughter, it's available on Amazon. Is that right?
It is. It's available pretty much anywhere you buy books, but very easily available on Amazon. And cool. I have it on sale, the Kindle version, for 99 cents.
Okay. So there's that. And then do you have like a website, or also do you have like a Facebook, or?
I have everything. My website is journeytomydaughter.com. Tried to keep it really simple. And all my social media is Jennifer Rose Asher.
Yeah, that's so great. I want to introduce you, Jennifer, to, I will be sending you an email, making some introductions to, I have the KS Media Group. And a lot of my clients are all podcasters that have grown their brand through video marketing, audio marketing, and getting their message out. A lot of them have guests on. And then there's, you know, you can fit in into quite a few of those if you're up to doing some more appearances and getting
your absolutely message out. Absolutely.
But I'll be happy to do that for you. And I wanted to talk even more about the horses because I thought that was also awesome. We didn't get to it, but maybe we will definitely meet each other again in the future, and we can come back and have another talk about.
I would love that. I would love that.
That's great. So everyone, thank you so much for tuning in and listening to the Cornelia Stephanie Show today. It was an amazing show. We appreciate you so much. If you're watching this show on YouTube, please like, share, and subscribe our YouTube channel. And then also right now, stay tuned for The Rosie Perez Show, Rosita Perez. She's helping you discover your way going back home. And then at 1 o'clock, stay tuned for Diane McClay, the Diane McClay. And she's going to be on for the 1 o'clock show. So thank you so much, everyone, for listening and tuning in. And we'll see you again next time. Thanks, Jennifer.
Thank you.
You've been listening to the Cornelia Stephanie Show, Wake Up to Love, your call to action. Tune in each week on Transformation Talk Radio. Cornelia's joy is to engage others in practical ways, showing us how to live in the new earth in harmony with our true nature. For more information on Cornelia and her extraordinary work, or to listen to past shows, go to her website at corneliastephanie.com.